Good afternoon, everybody. My name's Andrew, and I'm an addict. And today we're going to be looking through the laundry list of adult children of alcoholics and dysfunctional families. And just going over, there's 14 traits. Anybody that has a friend or a family member with an addiction, and it's an active addiction, can, or even somebody that's like looking to get away from their addiction but just hasn't really made the necessary action or isn't currently taking the necessary course of action to overcome such addiction, the family member or friend can benefit from adult children of alcoholics and dysfunctional families. However, we can't know about the solution until we're told about the solution. So we're going to go over this 14 number list here and just discover if this solution may work for us today together. So here we go. Number one, we became isolated and afraid of people and authority figures. I find that interesting that's included in the first trait as a pair. I'm not sure if that means we're isolating from authority figures or just being isolated in general. Like if we're separating isolation and afraid and just coupling it into the first trait, which is interesting that they did that here. Both are true for me. Became isolated, definitely, as a result of my addiction. And afraid of people and authority figures. These are just yes or no. There's no real, we don't need to go too deep in this first number here. We can, just not in this video. So I definitely answer yes to becoming isolated and being afraid of people and authority figures. Not anymore, but there was a time. Number two, we became approval seekers and lost our identity in the process. Powerful words there. If we're looking at the reality of our life in the past, those words hit hard. They do damage to the ego. This video is going to bring our fantasy world that we live in at times. Smash that and bring us back into reality for the duration of this video, if nothing more. So when we seek approval, attention-seeking behaviors, I need you to like me. I need you to tell me everything's going to be okay. I need you to tell me what I'm doing in my life is appropriate behavior. And if you tell me otherwise, I'm going to find someone else who tells me what I want to hear, because you're no longer a part of my inner circle. Goodbye. We gain our identity in that type of process. It's not the identity that we intend to have. But I'll see what you're doing And I'll see what that person's doing. And I'll see what that person's doing. I'll take all that in. All the stuff that I seem attractive. And I'll leave the rest behind. Until I create an image of myself that you will like. As long as you like what I'm doing, everything will be okay. And in the end, we come to find out that that's not really who we want to be anyways. Some of it, yes. However, there are some parts of it that definitely are not how we want to be living. Those are the character defects, and those are the things we're looking to smash out of our lives. We'll get into that a little later. Today we're just keeping it as tight to the laundry list as we possibly can without really getting into the solution. A whole lot. Until we are beaten into a state of submission, the steps will never work for us in the first place. Hint, hint, solutions. One solution. We have to first be willing, open-minded, and honest that we're in need of a solution to begin with. Henceforth, why we'll continue to read here this laundry list of traits. Without getting into too much detail. Number 3. We are frightened by angry people and any personal criticism. Wow. That's a very general and open statement. Because it doesn't really indicate the level of frightenedness that we face when we're faced with angry people and any personal criticism that we face. The level of scaredness that it causes us. This is just speaking in general. Depends on the source. Depends on the situation. Overall, it just depends on the moment. Sure, we can all think of a time where we become frightened by angry people and criticism, depending on the source of where the criticism is coming from. If we think back to our lives in the past, or maybe some things currently going on in our lives that we're dealing with today. And I'll speak for myself again. Number 3 is true for me. Number 4. We either become... I'm going to replace the word alcoholics with addicts. Because the word fits better for most people. Because alcohol is very general and specific to one addiction, whereas addicts includes any addiction. We become either alcoholics, marry them, or both. We become addicts. Addict can mean becoming addicted to relationships. Also included in that group, other human beings. Sex. Gambling. Pornography. Shopping. Money. Fame. Property. Social status, social media, self-serving behaviors. Or find another compulsive personality, such as a workaholic, to fulfill our sick abandonment needs. So I'll read that over again. We'll read that one more time. We become either addicts, marry them, or both, or find another compulsive personality, such as a workaholic, to fulfill our sick abandonment needs. Yes. This stems from our childhood, which we'll get into in a later video, in depth. Mom and dad aren't paying any attention to me. Nobody loves me. I need to go find somebody who loves me. I can't love myself. I'm incapable of that concept because I've never learned it. I'm going to go get it where I can. Anybody who's willing to love me, I'm going to reach out to and latch onto the second they pay any attention to me that I define as love whatsoever. And I'm not going to let go, no matter how unhealthy that relationship is. They love me. I'm going to cling on to that relationship because I feel connected. I'm no longer in abandonment. That's what we're talking about in number four. No matter how badly that person hurts me, when they're with me, I feel loved. I'm going to stay with that person. Come hell or high water. I can't leave them. Because I don't want to be alone. I would rather be in a toxic relationship than be alone. And we'll get more into that in a later video. That's just generally what number four means. Number five, we live life from the viewpoint of victims, and we are attracted by that weakness in our love and friendship relationships. You know when you see that dog on the side of the road that has like a broken leg and looks really sad, and you want in your heart of hearts to just pull over with your car, get out of the car, pick the dog up gently, and fix the dog by saving him, bringing him to a veterinarian, and just kind of caring for that dog until that dog is able to care for itself again. That's what we're talking about in number five. Poor me. That person hurt me so badly. Save me. I can't do this alone. I don't know the answer. I won't do that. I can't go there. I'm not capable of that. Oh, just because you can do that doesn't mean I can. I'm different. That workplace totally screwed me over. Look at how badly I've been affected. This is detrimental to society, what's happened to me. Poor me. Oh, you're feeling sick. Is there anything I can do for you? Do you want help? Oh, you need money. Okay, how much do you need? Oh, what do you need the money for? I've known you for quite a while, and I know you're an addict in active addiction, and I'm not quite sure that you're going to take this money that I'm about to give you and go to the grocery store and buy food with it. It just doesn't make sense that you actually need this money to do that, because you have enough money coming in, and I just gave you money 4 times in the last month, but I'm thinking that I might just give you some more. Because I love you. Even though I'm pretty sure you're about to go take this money to the casino. Or to the bar. Or to the drug dealer. But I just can't be 100% certain that you're lying to me again. So, here you go. And don't worry about paying me back. You can get me back somewhere down the road. It's okay. Oh, you want to have sex? Okay. Well, do you want a commitment? Oh, you do? Okay. Well, I feel the same way about you. Maybe it'll work. We don't know that much about each other, though. Are you sure it's a good idea? Maybe we should get to know more about each other before we carry out with this activity. No, you don't think the same? Well, we're both really horny. It'd be a good idea if we have sex right now. Okay, I'm going to give in. And we'll have sex tonight. But this does not mean that this can continue. Okay. I'm okay with that. And now we're boyfriend and girlfriend. Under the pretense that it's a monogamous committed relationship. Okay. Now 2 weeks later I get a phone call. I don't want to be with you anymore. I'm not ready for this. Oh, okay. And now I'm feeling hurt. Yeah. A sexual promiscuous relationship is what we're discussing now. They look so promising in the beginning, too. They look exactly the same as meeting our soulmate. Until that moment. Where you get that phone call or that text or meet them in real life and one of you says, I can't do this anymore. I only laugh because it's happened to me. I've been on both sides of the coin. There are better things in life, I'll just say that, than having that conversation. So again, we'll go over that. We live life from the viewpoint of victims. And we are attracted by that weakness in our love and friendship relationships. Number 6. We have an overdeveloped sense of responsibility, and it is easier for us to be concerned with others rather than ourselves. This enables us to look not too closely at our own faults, etc. This can totally be okay if you're already through the entire cleanup of your past and can now help others and focus specifically on that other person's issues, as long as the other person's willing to do the same amount of work. However, this can become a big problem if we have an entire past bag of issues to work with. And we don't want to work on that, so I'm going to focus on your issues. Put mine on the back burner. Because your issues help me not think about my issues. That's basically what we're talking about in number 6. And the overdeveloped sense of responsibility comes from our childhood, and it mainly stems from being neglected as a child. Maybe even to our teenage years. Where mom and dad just aren't all there. And maybe we're the oldest sibling or an only child, so we have to fend for ourselves, and we're taught to live a lot more maturely of a life, way earlier than we ever should as a child in reality. It's okay, it is what it is, it's just we may not fit in with certain social groups because we're just not thinking on the same level as them. We're thinking about going home and cooking supper at night when we're in grade 8. We're going home and thinking about doing our family's laundry and cleaning up the house and fixing everything, playing caretaker, being responsible at an age where those types of going to work, like say getting married at age 15, going to work at age 11 and 12 and getting a full-time job. Like, these are all things that people are forced into to develop that overdeveloped sense of responsibility at an early age and carry that into our adult lives, creating an unbalance in our world. Number 7, we get guilt feelings when we stand up for ourselves instead of giving in to others. This goes back to number 5, giving in to things like sex too early in a relationship, giving money to loved ones that we really don't have to give, giving of our time to another friend or family member that we really just don't have the time to spend with that family member or friend that day. Learning to say no, having trouble saying no. Learning when is the right time to say no and when can I maybe say yes and give in when I have that to actually give and give freely with no expectation of anything in return. I'm going to feel guilty for saying no to you. So instead of saying no, I'll just give in this time because it's easier to give in and not have to feel guilty about it than to say no and have you be mad at me or hurt or sad or lonely or upset. In general, that's basically what we're talking about in number 7. It's easier to say yes and alleviate ourselves of a feeling that we don't want to feel than to have the other person feel a way that we don't want them to feel. So we'd rather be the ones to feel a certain way that we don't want to feel than to have that other person feel a certain way as a result of us having to say no or even to say yes. Basically, our action is causing us to feel a certain way that we don't want to feel, all because we have trouble being assertive, standing up for ourselves, and letting the other person know that their behavior is not okay. It's not acceptable in our lives and in our relationships. However, we tend to be what we call walking mats or doormats, where we're accepting these behaviors, and the other person notices that, and now they're using that to take advantage of us. And we let this cycle continue for as long as we want to. As soon as we're ready to stop being walking mats and start standing up for what's right, what we believe in, that's when the solution becomes effective. That's what we're getting at in number 7. Again, I have all 14 laundry list traits, so this is not, I'm not preaching here at you saying you have this, you have that. I'm saying anybody who's like me, we have these laundry list traits. And the difference is we can choose to play victim and sit in the problem as long as we want, or we can understand that it's okay to have these 14 things or even 13 or 12 of them. Now it's time to move into the solution and do something about it. I would say even if you have one or two of these laundry list traits, the 12 steps and 12 traditions of adult children of alcoholics and dysfunctional families, or Al-Anon, which is the exact same program, pretty well, people can benefit from the 12 steps and the 12 traditions. If you have more than one or two, then I would say you definitely can benefit from the 12 steps and the 12 traditions. But first, we have to get through the last 7. Number 8. We became addicted to excitement. Anything that gives us that instant rush, that piece of instant gratification or personal glory or ego-driven activities, such as purchasing a huge investment or gambling on high stakes or going somewhere on a vacation that we're really not used to, or getting sexually involved in a relationship that we really shouldn't be getting sexually involved with at this time. any sort of behavior that is self-driven and has really no benefit in the long run, but it's going to make us feel really good right now, is what we're talking about in number 8. And this becomes addicting too. If it's something we can tap into, say pretty much anytime we want, like let's just get on the phone and call up this person because we can get a pile of drugs, or let's go to the liquor store and buy a big bottle of booze because it has a high level of alcohol content and we can just smash that back and get really drunk really quickly and then go to the bar and get drunk and forget about the night. Forget about the problems of life, at least for one night. But we're still going to have all those same problems tomorrow, but we don't care because you only live once. Let's have the best night of our life tonight and forget about everything. Let's live tonight as if it's our last. And we know damn well we're probably going to wake up tomorrow and feel even worse. But we're not caring about that because we are addicted to excitement. Let's roll the dice and we're hoping to get them snake eyes. Because we doubled down and now we're getting real dicey. Let's go to the horse track and bet on the long shot. Let's bet half our bankroll. No, screw it. Let's bet the whole kit and caboodle. Why? Because we can, damn it, and we will. That's exciting. We have a 50-to-1 shot of losing. We have a 1 in 50 chance of winning this bet. But by damn it, this is our night. Need a little bit of excitement in my life. Alright, well, I'm going to the strip club. See you later, honey. Oh, even better. I'm going to go race. I'm going to take my new Mustang that I just bought. I'm going to take her down to the track. We're going to race the quarter mile. And by damn it, we're not going to get caught by the cops. And if they start chasing us, we're going to pull away. We're going to floor it. And we're going to lose the cops. That's the plan. Man, oh man, that sounds exciting. Is it smart? No. Is it fun? Hell yeah. Is it good, long-term, healthy, and beneficial to the greater good in the long run? Not a frickin' chance. But is it going to cause us some great excitement today? You damn bet your bottom dollar it will. Number 8 was a big one for me, if you can't tell. And for many of us. It gets us out of that loneliness, angry, hungry, tired feeling, which are so dangerous to get into as human beings, because once we get into those modes, one or more, whew, we're in a really bad spot mentally, and we need to do something about it, or else it's just going to get worse, and then we're going to end up doing the complete opposite of what we should be doing to feel better in the long term. We're going to end up doing one of those unhealthy instant gratification behaviors that we just mentioned a few seconds ago. And if it's accessible, look out, because it's not likely to end anytime soon. And then it comes crashing down like a big wave eventually, and things are going to be even worse. But I don't care, because it's good now. It's almost like that relationship. Am I looking for Mrs. Right? Or am I looking for Mrs. Right now? Well, today I can tell you I'm looking for Mrs. Right, but it wasn't always that way. I was looking for Mrs. Right now, and I tell you, I was looking for Mrs. Right. I would tell her, sweetie, I'm taking you. We're going to go far. I'm going to spend the rest of my life with you. Eternity. I love you. I'm so in love with you, baby. And then the next day, be like, I'm sorry, I'm just not that into you. It's not you, it's me. That type of crap. And not think twice about it. That's the awful reality of it. Today, life is different. However, it's not something I used to laugh about. I'll just say that. There was some work that I needed to do, and that many of us do, to get through the awful guilt associated with hurting people in our lives as a result of our addiction. Number 9, we continue to love and pity and tend to love people we can pity and rescue. Oh, that person is so sick. Well, I just want to go rescue that person. Because I don't want to see them suffering. It really hurts to see them suffering. There's got to be something I can do. Well, that person's really not interested in treatment. But I just know I can fix them. With the power vested in me today, I'm going to do everything in my power to save that person and make it work. No matter how badly they hurt me, no matter how many times they lie to me, no matter how many times they cheat on me, no matter how close-minded, negative, and insane they are and unsafe to have around that person is, I'm going to do my best to fix that person. Because it's my job as a human being to help others. And that person, I really care and love. There's nothing in this world that I wouldn't do for that person. That's what we're talking about. It's kind of like a drop-off. Like if you just like pour your love out of a glass, it's never going to, like, because gravity has a downward pull, it's never going to fill the cup back up with love. So you're just basically, when we help somebody in that pitiful, sick position that is in no way, shape, or form able to give any love at all, and they're not willing to get help, but they say they are, well, we're just pouring the glass out of love and hoping that it's going to refill itself, but it never does. So what we have to do is we have to go seek outside help in order to fill that glass back up so that we can continue to try and fix and save that person. And then one day there comes a point where that person either becomes accepting of their disease and gets treatment for it, or we get so fed up and impatient and intolerant of that situation that we get out, we just walk away. Wash our hands. Our hands are now tied. This person has caused us too much pain, too much resentment, too much misery, sadness, loneliness, fear, that it's time to walk away. So, or we end up dead. Hopefully that's not the case. If you're watching this video, you're likely not dead. So, number 9 was a big one for me and for many of us in the program. Number 10, we have stuffed our feelings from our traumatic childhoods and have lost the ability to feel or express our feelings because it hurts so much. And in brackets it says denial. One of the things that used to affect me so much was when someone comes up to me and says, "How are you feeling today? Are you doing okay, Andrew? You just don't seem like you're very happy today." Oh, everything's great. Loving life. Not a care in the world. Meanwhile, on the inside, I'm hurting. I have a grandfather that's dying. I have a friend right in the middle of their active addiction. I have a loved one that's going down the toilet. And I'm actually in the middle of my active addiction too. But I don't even see it. Because I think that everything's just normal. Like that's just normal life stuff. That's how life's supposed to be. I don't know that there's a better life available. So I'm going to tell you that everything's okay. Thinking that feeling hurt constantly, suffering, and feeling lonely, and feeling hungry and angry, these are all just okay things, and that I don't deserve better. And deep down, I know I deserve better, but I don't have to have that today. I can just choose to stay in this today, and have that tomorrow. Tomorrow, things will be better. I'll do the work tomorrow. We'll do that tomorrow. We'll feel happy tomorrow. We'll feel peaceful tomorrow. We'll feel free tomorrow. But today we have to stay in this crap. Because that's where we're supposed to be today. I'm not allowed to feel happy. I'm not allowed to share that with you. In fact, when I do, I'm going to feel guilty because I know that that's not how you're feeling. And I don't want to be boasting about my happiness, or I don't want to tell you that I'm in pain because I don't think you'll understand. I think you'll judge me, and I don't think you'll accept me. I think you might laugh at me for crying. So I'm not gonna tell you what's going on inside my mind and inside my heart and in my life, because it just might hurt too much to hear what you have to say or see how you react or don't react to what I'm about to tell you or show you about my life. So I'd rather just stuff it, forget about it, and let bygones be bygones. Oh, that person is just really sick, so that's why what they're doing to me is okay. And I'm just gonna let it go for just a little bit longer here. They'll change eventually. I have faith that they'll change. Meanwhile, they're not actually doing anything to show the change. They're just continuously repeating the same vicious cycle of hurting me, walking all over me, lying to me, stealing from me. But eventually, there is hope for that person, that that person will realize just how badly they're hurting me as a result of their behaviors, and they will change. So I'm going to stand by them until they do. And we really believe in our heart of hearts that we're doing that. However, there always comes a time and point, because we're human, where we just can't take it anymore, and we have to walk away. Or die. One or the other. Yeah. And it all stems from childhoods. Don't talk about feelings. You're not allowed. Only talk about happiness. If you're not happy, I don't want to hear you cry. Don't talk about it. If you're angry, that's okay too. We're allowed to talk about anger. That's normal. It's normal to feel angry, but it's not normal to feel sad. Go to your room and cry it off alone, because I don't want to hear you. You're not important to me. Your feelings don't matter. Get over it. That type of stuff. We meet people that won't treat us like that. They're out there. I'm one of them. Number 11. We judge ourselves harshly and have a very low sense of self-esteem. Again, this just goes back to the I'm not good enough, I'm not worthy, I'm such an awful person for what I did in the past. I can't be accepted by society. I need your approval to feel good about myself. Especially physical beauty, like that's huge for society today. Most of society bases everything off of physical appearance first and foremost. Because what's the first thing we see when we go up to somebody for the first time and see them? We see their physical appearance, usually. Unless you're watching, like, The Voice or something like that, which is a music show for those who don't know, and the first thing the judges of the show hear or see of anything of the performer is their voice. Which I think is pretty cool. Because the performer can come out and look, however, and totally catch the judges off guard by their voice. And they're first accepted by their voice. Above anything else. And then we look at their physical appearance afterwards, which is pretty decent. And that, you know, that just stems from past relationships, people we think love us and look up to that person, like mom or dad or the spouse or something of that nature, telling us verbal abuse, like, you're going to end up in jail, you're no good, you're unworthy, you're an idiot, you're a screw-up, you're an F-up, you're a moron, you're an idiot. You're such low class. And actually believing that stuff. It's a self-fulfilling prophecy is what it's called. If we are told something and we think something about ourselves in our mind so often so, eventually we'll start to believe it. So it can be the opposite too, like, if we start to tell ourselves positive things and positive reinforcement and surround ourselves with positive individuals, well, eventually that's going to catch on and we're going to start to think that way and feel that way too. Number 12, we are dependent personalities who are terrified of abandonment and will do anything to hold on to a relationship in order to not experience painful abandonment feelings, which we received from living with sick people who were never there emotionally for us. Let's read that again. That's a huge one. That's a long sentence. We are dependent personalities who are terrified of abandonment. I need somebody in my life who can take care of me. And if I'm alone, that will just be the end of life. I can't be alone. We'll do anything to hold on to a relationship. No matter how badly I'm hurt, no matter how many times that person, I see the person that I met, and I have faith that that person will eventually be that person again. And if they're not, I will change them. I have the power to change that person into the person that I want them to be. And then we'll be okay. And really believe that. That's normal thinking. If you're a qualifier of codependency, that is totally normal. And it, although insane, it's sane thinking at the time. Actually thinking we have control over people, places, and things is totally acceptable thinking. And something we can even struggle with years and years of recovery. I've seen it in my life and I've seen it in the lives of others. It is real. We are dependent personalities who are terrified of abandonment and will do anything to hold on to a relationship in order to not experience painful abandonment feelings. It's easier to stay in the relationship than walk through the fear of not having that relationship any longer, which we received from living with sick people who were never there emotionally for us. Mom and dad are there physically. Spouse is there physically, but they're not there emotionally. I come with a problem, and now I need some emotional support, but where's mom? Where's dad when I need that? Where's the spouse, the significant other, when I need that? When I need them to be there for me the most, where are they? They're not there. They're off in la-la land in some fantasy world, and I'm doing that in my relationships too. I mean, in the past, I'm not there emotionally for anybody because my addiction is so much more important. But I won't tell you. I'll show you, but you'll be too blind to see it because you care about me so much that I just don't care that much about you as much as using you, taking from you as much as I possibly can. And when there's nothing left, we'll find a way for you to get more so I can take that too. Crazy. But normal thinking in addiction. And then the part is that we'll be there. On some days we're actually there and it looks really good. It's very attractive. And then it disappears again into the abyss. Where did it go? Number 13. Alcoholism is a family disease. And we became para-alcoholics and took on the characteristics of that disease, even though we did not pick up the drink. So it's actually said that the codependent in a family of an addicted home, like say of a family member that's an alcoholic or an addict or a sex addict, like a gambling addict or a drug addict, like narcotics or prescription pills or something of that nature, we actually take on those characteristics of that person. So now we're starting to feel self-pity. We're starting to feel lonely, angry, tired, hungry, resentful, remorseful. All these things that we can change, but we have to first identify that there's a problem and be okay with that and know that we can work into a solution. We have to first be beaten, like I said, into a state of submission, become willing to get the treatment, and then understand what that treatment entails. So, although we cannot change said person in our family or friends, we can change ourselves and become more loving toward the other people in our lives once we become more loving toward ourselves. It first starts with me. We have to clean up our side of the street before we can fix or help anybody else. And that's a process. It takes time and work. Number 14, para-alcoholics are reactors rather than actors. So I'm going to wait. I'm just going to sit back, hold off, and just see what happens. That type of mentality. I'm not going to do anything. I'm going to wait until the other person acts. And then I will act accordingly. And see how that works out for me. Like, it's just a simple number 14. Instead of taking action, I'm always reacting to situations. Okay, so that's all number 14 is talking about. I'm going to wait until they move, and then I'll move. I'm going to wait until they get help, and then I'll get help. I'm going to wait until they say something, and then I'll say something. I'm going to wait until they call me, and then I'll call them. I'm going to wait until they bring up that issue, and then I'll bring up that issue. Doesn't always work, although sometimes it is effective. And that's from Tony A, 1978. Now, there's the flip side of the laundry list too, so like what all these 14 problems turn into as solutions. So we'll get into that in a later video, my friends. I hope you all were able to take something from this video. If not, we all stayed clean for the duration of this video. We all got to know not only Andrew, ourselves, and maybe some family members, friends in our lives a little better as a result of this video. So we all can take something out of this video. Identifying the similarities and leaving the differences right out of it is going to help us a lot in taking care of our life today. So if you're new to the channel and you're interested in this kind of content, hit that subscribe button now, leave a like or a dislike, and a comment in the comment section letting me know what you think, how you feel, anything at all, what you want to talk about. Let's get that conversation going in the comment section right now. And I thank you for watching. Thank you for letting me spit, buzz, whip a little bit today. And I hope you all have a wonderful day. And with that, take care. See y'all later.